They come in from the dark sway of the sea, from lonely reefs and wrecked ships hairy with weed, wanderers of the ocean returning to spawn in the rivers of their birth. Britain's early invaders knew them well enough. From the banks of so many rivers, the Romans glimpsed the flashing beauty of the Atlantic salmon and the sea trout, and gave them both the same generic name, salmon, which means the leaper.
Just down here below me is a shoal of salmon and sea trout, fresh run from the sea. Now, these fish are sometimes said to be of interest only to a few anglers and a lot of gourmets. But, of course, this simply isn't true. Today, these fish should be of interest to every one of us because their very presence in a river represents clean, unpolluted water, such as this. It was Ruskin who said that landscape is part of a nation's wealth, and clean water and plenty of it is surely an essential part of that landscape. This is the age of safari parks and zoos and man-made lakes with stew pond fish, and we need these. But we also need our wild places with animals that are truly wild. And these salmon and sea trout are certainly wild. They're as wild as this little river and the fells beyond. They are part of a scene that we cannot afford to lose. They're two of the most astonishing and exciting animals in the world. I've known them for most of my life. And this is their story.
The time is late November. Now, in the upper reaches of the parent rivers, the salmon and sea trout have started to lay and fertilize their eggs. And the spawning of these fish comes right at the beginning of my story. Because although spawning is the climax of their return from the sea, the end of a fantastic journey, this is how and where it all begins. Many times in my life, I've watched the mating ritual. In such clear water, every stage of it can be seen, and it is fascinating. With flapping movements of her tail, this female salmon prepares a nest in the gravel in which to lay her eggs. The stones are sucked up from the riverbed with the flat of her tail and carried downstream, clear of the nest by the current. When she is nearly ready to lay, she hovers over the nest and presses down with her anal fin, seemingly to test the depth. Shortly after this, the male fish glides up and encourages her to mate by quivering violently. Now, the male's stimulation has reached its peak, and the female starts to extrude eggs. During the orgasm, the mouths of both fish gape wide open, and like a cloud of smoke, milk from the male fish drifts back with the current and mingles with the eggs, fertilization taking place at once. After mating, the female covers the eggs by flipping gravel over them in the same way that she prepared the nest, working from a position just upstream so that the current carries the gravel into place. The stones look like huge boulders, but in actual size, they're only an inch or so long. After spawning, most of the males and many of the females die. But each egg lies secure under its canopy of gravel. And gradually, a little fish forms inside, deriving oxygen from the water that flows between the stones. And after 3 or 4 months, it becomes an alevin, with an umbilical sac that holds a month's rations. And when these have been absorbed, the alevin wriggles out of the gravel as a fry. At about 3 inches long, the fry becomes a par. And after a couple of years or so, it starts to develop a silver coat. And when the little fish is fully silvered, it becomes known as a smolt and swims down into the river estuary and hurries out towards the open sea. And it goes to sea in order to grow. This migration is imperative. Few rivers contain a food supply that could support a large population of fully grown salmon and sea trout. Only by going to sea can these fish find sufficient food. Exactly where young sea trout go is unknown, but it's to feeding grounds off Greenland that many of our salmon go, and where during recent years so many thousands of tons have been netted that the species was brought almost to the point of extinction. This Greenland fishing has been reduced. But on their return to Britain, large numbers of fish are being intercepted off the west of Ireland, where netting is unrestricted. And far too many of the survivors are being trapped off our own coast. Some salmon return to fresh water after only a year at sea. Some after 2 years or more. But at whatever age, return they must, since they cannot spawn in salt water. And astonishing though it seems, tagging has shown that most fish come back to the very same rivers they grew up in.
That salmon can find their way back from the distant ocean to the coast is a fantastic feat of navigation. And nobody knows really how they do it. But scientists have proved that once a salmon reaches the coast, it can find its own river by sense of smell, by the particular odour of that river. The river it left when it went down to sea as a smolt. Where I'm standing, three rivers join and go out through this single channel round that distant sand spit to the open sea. But although all the returning fish have to come up this channel, they do so at different times of the year. The fish that run up this river start to run about the end of June. But the fish that run up that river start to run at the end of May. Whereas the fish that run up that little river don't run until the autumn. I've known this estuary for a great many years, and the behavior of the fish is so consistent that it seems certain that they must be coming back to their own rivers, guided, it seems, by their noses. And to us, all this is a miracle in itself.
But salmon and sea trout are two of the most hunted animals on Earth. During their time at sea, they've faced 1,000 dangers. And now, on their return to the coast, they face many more. Every cunning device that man can invent. But of course, they represent a crop that should be harvested, provided we're not too greedy. The catch is made by Bill Bailey of Lancaster, who shoots his net across Morecambe Bay in the solitude of a summer's evening. Cannot be compared to the wholesale slaughter made by fleets of drifters on the high seas. Whereas lave netting is certainly not without its humour. And the ancient Solway method of half netting is almost a sport. You just stand there and wait for a fish to swim into the net.
A knock there, lad, a knock there.
Billy Houliston of Glen Capel is fishing the River Nith. He was a great footballer, played centre forward for Scotland. The future of the salmon is not endangered by this form of netting, and least of all by the angler with his rod and line. Indeed, it's very much due to the anglers' fight for sensible conservation that we have the unpolluted rivers and the runs of fish that still remain in Britain. We've got water. Listen to Conrad Voss Bark and John Griffiths QC talking at the Fly Fishers Club in London.
No, we've never had before. And so what we've got to do is to get more salmon. We've got to conserve those stocks.
Absolutely right, Conrad. You know, I was up for a fortnight last autumn up on the Neff and I had 11 fish. And do you know, that was exactly one less than the total rod catch in 1900, which was 12.
In a year?
In a year. And in 1933, the Duke of Buccleuch got together all the fishing proprietors and they started to improve the river. By 1966, the rod catch was 2,811. And do you know how they did it? They went to the owners of the Tweed mills on the side streams and persuaded them to take down the calls, the dams, so the fish could run up to spawn. They persuaded the people who were polluting the river, particularly the sewage works, to stop doing it and put in special tanks to prevent the pollution, and they put in a fish hatchery. And 33 years saw a rise from about 20 fish a year up to 2,811. And I think that's a terrific story.
2,000?
Yes.
Good Lord.
2,811.
Oh, marvellous.
But what are the characteristics of these salmon and sea trout, or salmon trout as the fishmongers call them? Look at this catch of fish being hauled in with a dragnet on the shore. When you see them all laid out like this, you might think they were salmon. But they're not. Every one is a sea trout, even the big fellow on top with a sea louse on its tail. Large sea trout look very similar to small salmon.
Here's a salmon of 6.5 pounds and a sea trout of the same weight. And the salmon's tail has these two horns either side. The trailing edge is concave. The sea trout's tail is square. And when you get a sea trout larger than this, 10 or 12 pounds or bigger, the trailing edge even becomes convex. The difference between salmon and sea trout tails is so striking that you can tell salmon from sea trout even at a distance when the fish are lying in the river. Another difference is the wrist on the tail of a salmon, which enables you to pick a salmon up by the tail. But you can't pick a sea trout up by the tail. It's got no wrist, just here. If you try to pick it up, the tail collapses and slides through your hand. But the astonishing thing about these two fish is what they've got in their stomachs, which is nothing. On their return from the sea, when they come up the rivers to spawn, migratory fish do little or no feeding. During the months they spend in the river while waiting to spawn, they live on the supply of nourishment stored up in their tissues. Small sea trout take occasional food items, but the big ones very seldom. Salmon take almost no food at all. It's the nourishment stored up in these fish that make them such wonderful food. Just look at that colour, that gorgeous pink flesh. Fried in butter with some chives and some rings of cucumber, this will make a meal fit for the gods. Or as Isaac Walton once said of the pike, food too good for any but anglers and very honest men.
But the prolonged fasting of these migratory fish in fresh water provokes a fascinating question. Why on earth should any fisherman with rod and line expect to catch a fish that has no appetite, no interest in food? What kind of bait is he going to offer it? And when? And how?
I'm on a bank of the River Tay near Perth in Scotland. It's one of the great salmon rivers of Britain. And this is the start of the salmon fishing season, and it's very cold. It's sometimes laughingly referred to as spring fishing. But in mid-January, in this sort of weather, with the temperature as low as it is, there isn't much spring in the air. And to give yourself a best chance of catching a salmon when the temperature's as low as this, you need to fish a big lure, deep and slow.
But everything we know about salmon fishing has been discovered only by trial and error. Just why salmon should prefer a big lure at this time of the year, nobody knows. It's quite different from their behaviour in the summertime. Having stopped feeding and lost their appetites, salmon are obviously going to be difficult to catch. Indeed, what seems remarkable is that any are caught at all. Nevertheless, some salmon are caught because, surprisingly, they will occasionally take a lure. And the tackle makers provide an enormous range to choose from. There are minnows and spoons of every shape and size and colour. Although why salmon should take any of them is a mystery. Perhaps the most likely answer is that a salmon grabs a lure from force of habit, the feeding habit triggered off by the sight of something that may resemble the food the fish has been eating during its recent life at sea in a similar water temperature. Something tantalizing. But of course it could be due to anger or boredom or curiosity. The fish lie in a steady current of well-oxygenated water, concerned only with their breathing. And what is going on in their grey heads, I have no idea. 99 times my spoon may jinx and flicker temptingly past, and 99 times the salmon will ignore it. And then, perhaps on the 100th occasion, a fish will take it. The salmon is an enigma. The more we study its behaviour, the more mysterious it becomes. That fish wasn't hungry. It was neither feeding nor searching for food. Just why did it ever take my lure? It's this very uncertainty of salmon fishing that makes the sport so fascinating. It provides a limitless field of speculation, and whatever his experience, every angler is in with a chance. But salmon fishing is by no means a male preserve. Many women fish for salmon, and very successfully. In my opinion, their success is almost certainly due to their dogged feminine persistence, especially when there are very few fish about and salmon are hard to catch. They simply will not give up. At any rate, often enough the women will beat the men. On the same bitter January day, Florence Miller comes in with two salmon to my one. The most famous salmon angler of all time was a woman, Miss Georgina Ballantyne. In 1922, she hooked and landed the biggest recorded British salmon ever caught on rod and line. And here it is, a monster male fish weighing 64 pounds and 4.5 feet in length, almost as big as Miss Ballantyne herself. I'm standing here just to give you some idea of how big this fish really is. I span nearly 10 inches. Just look at the size of that head and the great hooked kype of the jaw, which is the sign of a male fish. Miss Ballantyne lived here beside the River Tay with her father, who was gillie for the local estate. And one October afternoon, she hooked her enormous fish in the swirling water below the cottage. There's a prize of £5,000 for anyone who can catch a bigger British salmon than hers. But so far, there are no takers. After 55 years, Georgina is still the champion. Winter turns to early summer, and with the change in season and the accompanying rise in water temperature, there's a mysterious and dramatic change in the behavior of the fish. Now, in May, instead of being tempted only by a big lure near the bottom, the fish will take a small lure near the surface. This lure is sportingly called a fly, but it bears no resemblance to a natural insect. The one I'm using is no longer than my thumbnail. How different from the lure I was using before? We don't know why the salmon have changed their preference. We've simply learnt it from experience. I keep a loop of line tucked under my finger to prevent a snatch if a salmon takes. Like a little shaft of light, the fly flickers slowly across the pool, a few inches below the surface. And when a salmon takes, there's just a tiny pluck and the loop of line slides out. You can't believe it's a salmon, it's so gentle. Then you lift the rod and the line is solid and you think you've hooked a rock. And then the rock moves away and you realize you're into a salmon. And it's pure magic. It's a beautiful little salmon, silver fresh from the sea. But why ever did it come up through 6 or 7 feet of water to take this tiny fly? That simply doesn't make sense. Nevertheless, in spite of its mystery, or perhaps because of it, the sport has an enormous attraction. Every year, more and more people are lured by the excitement and challenge of catching a salmon on a fly. But first, they have to learn how to cast a fly. And here to teach them on the Spey at Grantown is that expert angler, Arthur Oglesby.
Well, we have this situation today where the water's a little bit too high for good fishing, but if it's dropping, I always think a falling water gives us a better chance than a rising water. I wouldn't fish on a rising water myself. So there's a chance that somebody today will catch a fish. If you're going to catch salmon on a fly, you'll need a rod like this. In this case, it's a modern carbon fiber rod, 15 foot long, with a certain weight of line, in this case a number 10 line, because it is a weight we're going to cast. And to get our line out, we need to flex this rod at two points. There and there. We rock back on the left foot a little bit and flex the rod at two points. So the rod comes back just past the vertical there and down onto the water. Tick, tock. Think of a clock going tick, tock, and think of the pendulum going back and forward. Don't push like that, because if you think about it, it merely just pushes the rod like that, and we want the rod to serve as a spring when we're casting and as a lever when we're playing a fish.
But there'll be no playing a fish until the fly can be properly cast. And a lot of practice is needed to make that perfect. So here on Speyside, practice is the order of the morning. And for some, perhaps, the afternoon as well.
I should take it down slowly now. Hold it. Hold it. Thank you, babe.
But casting is only the start of salmon fishing. Even when you can cast as expertly as Grace Oglesby, you still have to learn how to control the speed of the fly. And to do that on these big rivers, you need to wade, and to wade deep. But deep wading is not without risk. It's very easy to get swept out of your depth. One false step could drown you. And this doesn't apply only to anglers. Accidents can happen to anyone who goes near deep water. Every year, numbers of holidaymakers are drowned. And so many of these fatalities could be avoided.
It's been said, and the number of people who believe it is surprising, that if you fall into deep water, fully clothed and wearing long fishing waders, your boots will drag you down. I assure you, they will do nothing of the sort. It's a perfectly simple matter to swim fully clothed and wearing long waders. And although your boots don't make it any easier to swim, they certainly don't make it impossible. Indeed, the air that's trapped in your boots and in your clothes will help to keep you afloat if you only give yourself half a chance. It's panic that drowns most people when, for whatever reason, they suddenly find themselves plunged into deep water they go, ah! Two involuntary actions, both fatal. Arms up, the body sinks. Mouth open, water rushes in. Pay no attention to those stories of drowning men coming up three times. If you take enough water aboard first time down, you won't come up at all. But if you keep your arms down and your mouth shut, you'll soon bob up again. Now, this pool is 15 feet deep. It's got a strong, swirling current going through it. I'm fully clothed. I'm wearing these long fishing waders. It's a cold day, and I'm 60. But if I fell in that water now, I'd be perfectly safe. And I'll prove it.
Soon bobbed up again, you notice. Now, swim on your back. Spread your arms out, paddle with your hands, and keep your head right back in the water. And let your legs come to the surface, and they will, no matter what sort of waders you're wearing. If you raise your arms, you go under. Put them down and you come up again. Float with the current feet first. Then your boots will strike a rock and not your head. And when you reach the shallows, don't try to stand up at once. Roll over onto hands and knees and crawl out. It's difficult to walk with long waders full of water. But if you kick them off, you may skin your feet on the rocks. So just lie down and let gravity empty them for you.
You see, there's really nothing to it.
Anyway, I hope I've made my point that falling into deep water needn't be fatal. It explains why I can wade without being frightened of drowning. And wading deep has helped me to catch a lot of salmon. The world turns and the rivers fall. And now in the heat of midsummer, we take up the story of the returning sea trout. During a long drought, the little Cumbrian Spate River near my home has shrunk to a mere trickle between the pools. The gauge stands at zero, well below summer level. A rise of water encourages most fish to run. But even in water as low as this, some sea trout will come splashing up river as soon as darkness falls. These astonishing night runs of sea trout are very exciting. The fish come zipping up through the shallows, then splash over the sill of the weir and glide on into the deeper water above. Although the river is far too low for salmon to run, either by day or by night, sea trout force their way up from pool to pool through stickles only a few inches deep. But the majority of the sea trout, together with the returning summer salmon, are waiting in the estuary for a rise of water. Sooner or later, even the longest drought must end. In an interval between thunder showers, a snail comes out for a drink of water. And a thrush comes out for the snail. But on this rare occasion, the most remarkable sight of all is provided by the sea trout. Suddenly, the tired river starts to dance and sparkle with a new flush of oxygen. And the moment is seized. We are watching in the daytime a run of sea trout similar to the run we saw at night, and in the very same place. Only now we can see the fish themselves. This is a very unusual sight. It isn't often you can watch sea trout running so far upstream during daylight in such low, clear water. It's the result of freak weather conditions, A sudden heavy rainstorm after a drought of exceptional length. This sea trout rests for a moment, then swims on and joins another that is lying a yard or two above the sill of the weir. A fish with a strangely dark back follows it up. And then the other two fish continue their journey upstream together, swimming at their normal running speed, about 1.5 to 2 miles per hour. Very different from the speed of frightened fish. But now the storm has broken higher up the valley and the water is rising rapidly. After such a long period of dry weather, the river soon turns dark with peat drainings and dirt from road surfaces, and a mass of flotsam gets swept downstream. The storm is over, and as the dirt clears from the water and the level starts to drop, anglers appear on the river banks, my wife Kathleen among them. On most small rivers, there's a short period during the later stages of a spate when salmon and sea trout seem suddenly eager to take a bait. I call it the magic moment. Just why the fish behave like this, I cannot explain. But from experience, I know that many hours of blank fishing may precede and follow such a period of activity, which, even when you have an intimate knowledge of the river, is by no means easy to predict. On this occasion, I had fished until supper time without an offer. So had my friend, Michael Horden.
Well, Mark, I don't know about you, but I'm getting very hungry.
Yes, me too.
Anyway, the magic moment's long since passed. I don't get much chance now.
Oh, yes, there is.
Put him.
Look what I've caught. A lovely salmon.
Oh, it's marvellous.
That's super.
Where did you catch it?
In Medadub.
Clever girl.
Oh, great. How wrong can I be? Are you coming back for some food?
No, I'm going to catch another one. Come, Prince.
Oh, jolly good luck.
When my wife goes fishing, time takes on an entirely new dimension.
Oh, meaning no supper?
Michael, if we want any supper, we will have to cook it.
You mean you'll have to cook it?
Why, no, chap, if you'd like to risk it. And don't forget your net.
Hmm? Oh.
He'd be a bold man who pretended he knew anything about the psychology of these fish. But we can observe something of their behaviour when the level falls in these clear water streams. Lying in this pool on a bed of gravel just down there below me is a magnificent shoal of sea trout that came up with the recent spate, part of the main midsummer run. These fish are all sea trout. Look at the big square tails, so typical of trout as we saw earlier. They are truly wild animals, straight from the sea with tide lice clinging to their flanks. Quite content to lie where they are. They're not hungry. They're making no attempt to search for food. After all, there's hardly any food to search for in a spate river. Just about enough to feed the youngsters and a few diminutive brown trout. Like salmon, sea trout can be caught on a variety of lures at any time of the day. But unlike salmon, they take best at night. Extraordinary though it may seem, in many rivers, it's after dark that sea trout are most likely to be caught. Look at that big fellow swinging around on the right, fat as a pig. And what a tail he's got. For me, night fly fishing is the very cream of angling, as it is for all the friends who stay with me in the summertime.
Dee dee. There's my cast. Now, you. What fly, eh?
I think of medicine.
Ah.
To start with.
Now, one of them?
Yes, for the first part of the night.
Very good. Hoped you'd say that, because I tied these specially last week.
That's very nice.
And then what?
Oh, well, look here, after midnight, I can certainly go on to a sunk lure with a sunk line.
Yes. Yes, all right.
And remember, when the night turns cold, the fish go down and stay down.
Mm.
So we've got to go down too.
Yep. And that would be, on a night like this, about what sort of time?
I should think after, well after midnight, say 1:30, 2 o'clock in the morning.
Yes, and then if one stays out until dawn, you come back, presumably, to the fly again.
I think I'd come back to a medicine at daybreak.
Ah, very good.
On a sink tip.
Yes. There we go, half blood. That's the knot you use, I expect, is it?
That's right.
One. Five. Not as good as I used to be in the eyes.
Oh, God, what a marvelous evening. Perfect. Where would you like me to start you?
So if you start at the bottom of the beat and fish up,
uh-huh.
I'll start up at the top and fish down, and we'll meet at the bridge at daybreak.
Lovely.
Good luck.
From the rafters of an old farm building, a hunting barn owl flaps on silent wings across the water meadows. You are never really alone on a river bank. At dusk, out come all the animals that hunt in darkness and keep you company at the waterside.
Of course, you don't see many of these nocturnal animals. One or two owls, a nightjar perhaps, a roe deer that comes down to the river at dusk. Perhaps, if you're very lucky, a badger. There's a badger that comes down sometimes in the summertime from the woods up on the fells there and hunts along the riverbank. Lives in a temporary set that is dug out of an old rabbit hole. Works on both sides of the river, crosses over by the little bridge I've just come across. And one summer, he took a fancy to this little fishing shelter. More than once, I've come down here at dusk to fish for sea trout and found the badger sitting here in possession. Quite enchanting. It lends another dimension to the sport of fishing. You know how true that motto of the Fly Fishers Club, Piscator non solum piscator. There's more to fishing than catching fish. Come on, boys, let's get away up river. Come on, then. Heel.
In the fading light, the river bank slowly changes into a different world, silent and enchanting. For the sea trout fisherman, dusk has its own particular delight. An owl hoots from shadowy woods. No other sound except the murmur of the river. And then suddenly, the splash of a sea trout in the pool below. That could be a running fish. On the other hand, it could be lying there, restless and perhaps ready to take. Well, I shall find out. To start fishing too soon in such low, clear water is a great mistake. But it's dark enough now. The sun has long dipped behind the fells and local colour has disappeared. I fish with tense anticipation. At each cast, expecting that sea trout to take the fly. I can no longer see the pitch of the line. But I can feel the movement of the fly as it swings across the pool. To fish well at night demands absolute concentration. Even the cry of an owl can be distracting. But there's nothing more disruptive than the sound of the human voice, which is why my two Labradors are the ideal companions. They don't chatter. But now a real setback Behind my shoulder, a full moon comes sailing up above the fell. Casting with the moon behind the rod is hopeless. The long shadows flickering down the pool would frighten every trout. This is my last chance of catching that fish that moved. But I still can't get him to take. Now I've changed my ground. Here I can cast towards the eastern sky. Even though bright moonlight is flashing on the water, I'm in with a chance. Suddenly a fish moves just above me. A good fish too, by the sound of it. Now that could be a taking fish. I start to edge up towards him, fishing with great care. Sea trout are the shyest fish that swim. You don't get away with a clumsy cast in bright moonlight. To stalk a fish in a known lie is so tremendously exciting. I'm getting near to him now. The next cast should cover him. I want the fly to flicker temptingly past his nose. Now, surely. Yes, I've got it. He's a good fish, all right. Sea trout fight like tigers. So easy to lose them when they leap. But he's nearly ready to land. If he'll only stay on while I get the net under him. Now's the time when they come off, just as you draw them into the shallows. Not this one. Its silver flank flashes in the moonlight. A perfect sea trout between 6 and 7 pounds, straight from some distant tide rip. Of all fish and fishing, this for me is the very top. The short midsummer night is nearly over. There isn't much time if I want to catch another fish. But for a while, I just sit there in the silence, absorbed by the magic of that moonlit water. With the light from my little cottage shining across the valley.
Hello there, Michael.
Oh, hi, Hugh, there you are.
I went to the bridge, but you weren't there, so I came on up.
No, I'm sorry. I'm a bit late. I just got into a beauty down there and lost it.
Oh.
I got three, though.
Well, Dad, you beat me.
How do you do?
I got a couple.
Uh-huh.
One's a nice one, though. Uh-huh. How about that?
Oh, gosh.
About 6.5.
Oh.
He took just as the moon came up over the fell.
That's a good sight.
Yeah, so is that.
Well, All too soon, it seems, the summer has gone. The air has a chill of winter. The short, dramatic sea trout midsummer nights are only a memory. Now a November wind strips off the last leaves, carpeting the rivers with willow and oak and ash and sycamore and alder. Beneath the drifting leaves, late-running fish are swimming steadily upstream. And in the wild mountain rivers, what they cannot swim over, they leap. But not all of the fish are destined to arrive at the spawning raids. Ulcerative dermal necrosis is a disease that will break out at any time of the year, but seems more prevalent when the water temperature is low. Open sores in the skin become covered with fungus, and many fish swim into the shallows where they lie like stranded submarines. If such a fish survives long enough to spawn, its journey will not have been in vain, for the eggs are viable. But this fish will never reach the raids. And there are other dangers. This small salmon has been intercepted by an otter, a female fish, as we can tell by the shape of the head, from which every morsel of flesh has been stripped. The remains are typical of an otter kill. The backbone has been picked clean with hardly a broken rib. The skin has been folded back like a concertina without even a tear in it. The otter can do all this using only its teeth and forepaws. What a marvelous feeding skill. By mid-November, the surviving salmon and sea trout are reaching their journey's end. Already, some of them have arrived at the raids. The magic of their mating made possible simply by a sufficiency of clean water. We are back where we began. By midwinter, most of the spawning is over. The surviving fish have started to make their way seawards. The others lie staring at the sky. But the eggs that ensure a future generation are buried safely in the gravel. For Salmo the leaper, this is both the end and the beginning.